Just imagine a trip to a wonderful land of candy and jam and ice cream.
I gotta hit that string, you better watch it. Whip, I got that attack with a full clip. I got the whip, got the preaching that I keep undercover. All up in the cup, just to live it up. See this stone cold face, try to knock it. I keep it tight, never walk on the rocket. I got a beat in it, I got a frip in it. I got a beat, 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 got a beat.
Tell me who, tell me you don't know what to do. Get it all over you. Oh, know how to fight only you. Tell me why, tell me who, tell me you don't know what to do. Get it all over you. Oh, know how to fight only you. We'll be right back.
Can you hear me? Because it's going to be faster if I don't type it, but I'll just talk, I guess. So, faces, muzzles, they're all kind of the same. You just gotta like learn proportions and how to move them around. Like if you want to draw that oriental short hair, I would say a good base. So like basically a base for a cat is you draw the circle in fourths, and then the muzzle is around here. Eyes are here. Ears, the where the ear ends here, it'll line up basically with the corner of the eye. And then this other, where the ear ends down here, it'll be kind of also like this. So, and then the top of the ear kind of rests on the top here, and then the back of the head. The song is much lower, isn't it? I turned it down like all the way. So this will be a cheekbone. This is really the eye socket. This will be a cheekbone. So if you're doing a plane, it would go like this. And then the jaw is around here. The nose, so the corner of the eyes will line up with the corner of the nose. Kind of makes like a little triangle. There's another. The cheekbone goes here, and then if you're drawing from the front, the muzzle will kind of come from where it meets the nose. And then the chin is here. Usually their jaw meets at the bottom, but if they're like fat or something, might not. Cheekbone, their little eyebrows really go here, forehead. So that's pretty basic. And then if you were going to draw like a face over that, you know, it's pretty straightforward from there. Another thing to notice, depending on the angle of like the eye, the eyelashes will become more or less visible. Like if you're drawing it from above, the top of the eyelash top will kind of stick out, and so will the bottom, because it's basically like an orb that looks like this. But if it's from kind of a head-on perspective, when you tilt it up a little bit, a way to kind of sell the dimension is to make the bottom a little bit like a skinny line, like it's kind of cupping it, and then put the bottom of the eyelash kind of poking out at the end. So this is going to be a more realistic cat, I guess. They can have a little divot in their nose, but obviously, because it's animation, it's sometimes easier just to draw a triangle. But I usually draw a triangle, but then when they're looking down, I'll put the divot in the nose to sort of sell the angle. And the way when the eyes are looking front on, another thing is like the way the sort of eyelid and face and nose bridge curls is you'll see more of the eyelid at the end of it rather than the corner, right? And then sometimes I do a thing where I'll put this here with this little line, and then I'll color this in like pink to draw their waterline, because that's usually pretty visible. You do a little bit of eye horn. What is that called? Tear duct? I don't know. So there's cat the muzzle. I find a lot with the muzzle, especially if you're animating it where it's moving, you don't really need to draw the whole muzzle. You can just sort of imply that it is the shape it is, as long as you put it on the right part of the face. Like, okay. Ear hairs. So, like, imply the muzzles here, but there, put a little bump here, and then maybe go like this. And then, you know, it just kind of sells the shape as long as you put it in the right spot. The ear overlaps a little bit on the top of the head. And then connects like here. Pretty easy. Back of the head will be a little bit behind the ear, because they have long skulls. This isn't super even, but whatever. So there you go. This ear's bothering me. I made it off. It's not going as straight as the other one. Then obviously ears are the same height as each other. I mean, honestly, with cat teeth, I'm not even an expert with that. I just kind of wing it because I know, like, the general positions of teeth. So, the sketch is kind of bungo or whatever, but I guess you can get my point. I'll just move that. There's a lot of leeway with cat eyes. I think to keep in mind is, like, character design with eyes. Like, you can add cool shapes to them and whatever. Like, you don't need to always draw the same eye over and over with your characters. You can mix it up with just little things. And let's see, teeth. When I draw a basic cat muzzle, so like usually when I draw a cat muzzle, I'll like make a general shape. Like if it's open, I'll do this. Then I'll draw like this and this. Then I'll nose, end of mouth, open mouth. Cats, the bottom of their mouth's kind of skinny. Their lips are black. Go here. Yeah, so I usually just go like this for the front teeth, I guess. I don't know. As that other person said, the bottom teeth go in front. This is, like, teeth are more detailed, but, like, this is really all you need to sell it, is kind of, like, these shapes. So, the thing is with front teeth, is so their bottom jaw is a little bit smaller than the top part of the mouth. So, these fit in here. So, if the mouth is closed, the bottom teeth fit here. It's like this. They like fit together like that. So there's that. Also for like cats' heads, like their skulls are kind of long. I feel like people like don't draw the back of the head enough a lot, so it can make their heads look like too short. Because usually their skull is like here, the ears come out here, back of the ears like this, their little cheek thing, cheek, skull, eye socket, forehead's kind of small, nose bridge, muzzle, chin. This is really bad. And then their head goes like this down in their neck. Kinda like that. If you ever distilling cats into shapes, like these cats are many shapes. That oriental, long face, the muzzle here. The ears kind of line up with the sides of the cheekbones. The nose bridge is pronounced. The eyebrows. Kind of a shallow forehead. There you go. This Persian. So, if you look at the shape of his face, his little forehead. Kind of like a big hexagon. His muzzle goes really down, and the chin is pretty high. Little flat nose, pushed out, pronounced forehead, and then he has little ears, and then his neck fluff is like this. So, like, that's pretty easy, right? And then, I don't know, like, the bottom ones, those guys are a little bit similar, but they have pretty similar shapes, I guess. So, if you're gonna draw this brown and white cat, the faces are kind of angular, but not as angular as the oriental. Little nose. Muzzle's kind of round, little chin, eyes, bad eyes, the ears are pretty pointy on this one, and then he has a lot of fluff that comes out and then comes back in, big cheek, and then kind of skinny chest, and then the one beneath him is like similar. But the muzzle's a bit bigger. So the chin. His head's more of like a diamond. More rounded, smaller ears. His fluff sticks out, but it's not as long, so they just kind of, it's kind of plush. Yeah, there you go. That's a basic shape. You could work off of that. And then, like, squash face. Like, what I've noticed with a lot of squash face cats. So, like, if this is the profile of a normal cat, or the average kind of house cat, a squash face cat is the kind of have like an apple head where they're, where it comes out and it goes back down, and then their muzzle kind of goes back. Their eyes are closer to the nose bridge, and then their chin kind of sticks up, and their head is kind of shaped like this, and they have little ears, and it's fluffy. So like their eye will be closer to their nose bridge, but their forehead will kind of stick out more. It'll slope less. It's more rounded. And then their nose. Yeah. So that's something to keep in mind when you're drawing like Yellow Fang or whatever, from the side. And then, I don't know. I guess when I draw like Tiger Star, I usually like do something like this. Don't be afraid to just connect the bottom of the muzzle with the chin, because like from a lot of angles, cats just do look like that, and I feel like some people try to avoid it, and then the angle looks wrong. Then you can just kind of. There's Tiger Star, like a basic Tiger Star shape. Faces, I guess, like, really all you can do with faces is just kind of draw a lot of them and practice, like, different proportions. They don't even need to be good. Like, you don't need to post them. And usually when I'm drawing, like, a cat from another angle, I do the ball thing, there's the front, back of the head, the ears come out here, the eyes are going to sit somewhere along this line, the nose bridge is going to come out, you're going to extend the line, draw it down, another line, there it is. Their cheekbone, cat skulls, they have really big eye sockets and their cheekbones come out the front, so like a cat skull, like looks like this, like it does, and the jaw comes out here, and then they have little ear holes. They have a bone ridge on the top of their head, and this is where their jaw muscles connect from the bottom. They like, so when you humans also have it, basically the more bite pressure an animal has, the larger this ridge will be, because more muscles are connecting to it. Cats is pretty small, but it's kind of like a fin at the back of the skull, and it goes back, and then a cat skull looks like this. I mean, this is just from memory, but so that's why when I draw cats from the front, because their skulls are a little different than ours, when I draw their ears, I'll draw this sort of little ridge at the back if they don't have like hair there, because they have that fin on their skull that sort of bumps their head up a little bit. Dogs are pretty pronounced because their jaws are so large. If you look at one on like a hyena or a gorilla, it's huge. So if you're ever struggling with an angle, the cheekbone would stick out. And you don't need to like, because I see people do this with they always connect the muzzle to the bottom of the eye. You don't need to do that. Usually use the nose to define that, then have the muzzle connect to the cheekbone directly. It kind of has a better, like, silhouette, because when you look at a cat, it looks more like that's what's happening, rather than the muzzle traveling all the way up to the eye, because you won't really see it anymore. It'll sort of transition into the cheekbone. So you would do something like that, because cats kind of have a round head. And I feel like if sometimes when you transition the muzzle directly into the cheekbone, because their noses and their muzzles really aren't that big, I feel like that's what can stumble a lot of people, because then it makes them look a little bit more dog-like. It makes their muzzle, like, kind of pronounces the muzzle more than it needs to be. Maybe, I don't know, that's just my thought. If you want to do that, that's fine. If that's how you like your cats to look, that's just how I feel. That's why I don't do it. So, like, you can't, because that sketch is kind of messy. I'm just going to quickly do this. Yeah, so, like, I don't know if you can see what I mean with that. But, like, you don't need to do this, basically. See how it kind of, it implies the, I mean, like, if your cat has a big muzzle, then yeah, you can do that. But you don't need to always, when you're from an angle, do this. Because it sort of implies there's more volume here than there is, when really their muzzle just sort of, it kind of goes like this, more so, if you're going to put a line there. Because their mouth goes here, and then it meets with the cheekbone, and then it goes like that. But I feel like connecting it, and then it's also just, it's one less line to draw when you're animating. It's easier, you know, why not? And then paws, I feel like paws are flat, kind of, like, if they're just holding their paw out, it would basically, their middle two digits are a little bit higher up. Then they have this one and this one to varying degrees, and it goes up. And then they would have their little thumb here, and this will kind of travel up the arm and then come down because it connects to a higher part of the wrist. Let me just get some paw references and I'll draw it. I guess this is pretty good. Hold on. So, these are some paws from the bottom. I guess it'll work to illustrate my point. So, when I draw paws, so it's kind of like a hand, if you look at it like a hand. So these are the toes. This is their palm. Their thumb is here. This is kind of the bottom of their palm. This pad isn't a digit. It's like, you know, like the base of your palm, like where the thumb is. Because you have the softer part in the middle, and then you have the top part and the bottom. This is just like a pad. It's like the bottom of their palm. You gotta let me finish one thing first. So it'd be like the, let me look at that actually. So this I have a whole diagram of paws and shit on my Instagram. I guess I can go find it. It's the paw pads. And then they kind of go in a little bit here. So they would connect about here, and you can't really see it because of the fur, so it doesn't matter. And then the pad is like this. And this is their thumb. Their wrist is around here. Right? Let's get my paw thing. Hold on. Because I did like an assignment like a year, almost 2 years ago now, where I drew like a fuck ton of feet and paws, including their bones and stuff. Let me find that. I am scrolling. I think I'm almost there. Here it is. Okay. Can I copy this image? No. Whatever, I'll just send the link in the stream. So I did that. And I compared them to a human hand. So these links, the first one is cat paws, and then the second one, it's like hands and paws, and then bird feet and wings, and then like human feet and hands. So the first one, the cat paws, so I don't know if you guys have thought of this, but hairless cats are really good if you want to learn how to draw paws, because they don't have fur obscuring their structure. I'm just going to screenshot this and then open it and then go over it in the stream, because then I won't have to draw it again. And these are much more well drawn than anything I would sketch out right here. So, so this is their bones. So their hand, if I was going to draw a paw over this, it would look like a simplified cartoon one, if you can see what I mean. It would look like this. Basically, it would be like this, something like this. Right? Because really, when... Like, so, these are the tarsals. And the tarsals, like, if you looked at your hand, that's, like, the bulk of your hand. You can feel them, like, they extend from your knuckles, the bottom of your hand where your palm is. You can feel them if you move your hand. You can feel those little ridges. Those are tarsals, and then, or carpals. Sorry, I'm thinking of toes. And then these are metacarpals, which are your finger bones. And the thing is with cats is at their final finger bone, the nail actually grows directly out of it. And so if it was a human finger, your fingers would always be kind of like this, and this would be your hand. And then when cats are... unsheathing their claws, it's basically their finger extending outward. So they kind of always have them folded. So it would be like if you walked with your toes, like if this is your foot and you walk with your toes like this, like all the time, like up and scrunched. But that's just how they naturally are. And then if you extended them, like your claw came out. So these are drawn from hairless cats. So this is kind of what I described earlier. They have a lot of flesh and skin on their paws. They kind of have semi-webbed toes, which are covered with fur. So when you're drawing a cat paw, extending their claws, you don't want the digits to be like this, really. Like super, like if you don't draw like the fuzz in between their toes, then they look really finger-like. Because we have webbing between our fingers, but it's really... small, right? It's really not that pronounced. Cats have much more. So, like, you could see how these would come across as kind of fingery, like they're too skinny, they're too long. When cats extend their paws, because they're fur and skin, you really only see the last digit, and then this is kind of, because the skin is connecting it, and then there's fur on that, and there's fur on their toes as well. So you wouldn't really see the rest of the digit. If you're going to draw it, I would say draw like the silhouette like this, where it's kind of like this, and then you would kind of draw the implication of it. Disney does it really well. Like if I was going to draw like a Disney paw with its claws outstretched, you would just, you drew these, you know, like rectangles, make a line, and then you would kind of go like this. And then draw like a paw pad and stuff, right? That's really shitty, but like you get what I mean. And then also what helps also when you're drawing outstretched paws, if you want them to be even, is you kind of draw like a rainbow and then you draw like them in that. And then they'll all kind of line up. And so like these are their claws when they're not outstretched, so you can see that they kind of have this zigzag because the bone is like scrunched up here, right? So that's what cats are like all the time, is all their bones are kind of doing this, and then when they're extending, they go like this, right? These will like, so it's like this, and it's like this. So if he extended his bones, it would be like, and then this would stretch out a little bit. Because this is more, the dew claw, it's shorter. It's used basically just to grip rather than scratch. Like when a cat scratches, its dew claw isn't really what it's going to be using primarily to do that. That's more for gripping when they're climbing or like grabbing prey. These are hind legs, which basically have the same principle, but so cats, their rear dew claws are not retractable, so they actually kind of go down more like a dog's, where they just come out. They aren't retractable because they use them for they're kind of like cleats, like when they're running, you know, to grip the ground better. So with this one, you can see, so this is a front paw, so this is the wrist, and this is where the tarsals are in the hand or the paw, and they connect to all the fingers. Fingers come down. This is where their skin flap is, right here. So, and then this is like a walking paw, and it's kind of like that, with the bones in it. So their wrist, when they stand, this is the wrist with the radius and the ulna here. So the radius, I forget which one is the bigger one, but one of them's in front, and it'll be here, and then this, and the one of them is behind. And when you draw, the muscle connecting the wrist bone kind of wraps around a little bit, and it connects sort of to the front bone, not the back. So if you put a little overlap when you draw, so let's say you're drawing a paw, if you put a little bit of overlap here when you draw the connecting line from the thumb, the dew claw, like this, and then, okay, so this is the tarsal, or the carpals, I keep confusing them with hind legs, and then these are their finger bones, and you were drawing like a cartoony paw, and then also the front of the paw goes a little bit in front of the dew claw, so it's kind of like layered. This is not like a very good drawing, but you would, so if I was gonna make this more stylized, I would do this, basically. Right? Not that hard. Kind of has a flow to it, I guess. Dad?
What?
Hi. I guess that's all I have to say on paws. I guess if you're doing hind legs, like you're connecting them to the rest of the body. So like, this is their, this is, if this is the hip, This is the femur, kneecap, tibia, and whatever. This is their heel. These are their tarsals. This is the paw, the finger bones. And then the meat of it. So, like, if this is like their hip bone. The meat of it kind of goes in this, so they have more muscle on the back of the leg. Like, look at your own thigh. And then this is like their, this is their calf. This is their heel. Right? And then they usually have like a skin flap here that connects it to the stomach, which goes up in here. This is their spine, tailbone. Cat spines kind of go up. There you go. So if you draw that structure and then you draw on top of it, cats, like skinnier cats, it goes up and then they kind of have this skin flap here or here, but then lots of cats are fat and it hangs down. But I'm just gonna do this. So, like, yeah, that's a pretty simple hind leg. And then usually when I draw hind legs to sort of enunciate, because they're kind of bony, I guess, more so than other parts, I kind of usually draw this shape. Then I draw the calf, and then the heel, and then the rest of the paw, or something like that. This is, like, weirdly shaped, but I don't care. So that would be a really rough one. And then so, also, because, so, like, I usually do a little bump here, because this is where the fingers are. And then, like, I usually do that. And then another thing, the muscle kind of goes like this and then connects with the heel. So I usually do something like this and then I connect it like that, which is a really kind of simple way. If you control where you're overlapping your stuff, you can use less lines to show more form, basically. So if I make the muscle in the back come forward and connect, wrap around the front, connect to the heel, because they have a tendon here. This is their Achilles tendon. So there's kind of like a divot there in their leg, and you can sometimes see their bones. So if there's like a skinnier cat, I'll make it more pronounced. If it's a thinner cat, I mean a fatter cat, then usually I'll just do a little bump like that. Yeah. It's kind of, I don't know what else I can say. And I guess a very simple way to break down the cat body is if you, so like, I don't know, this is the head. This is their neck. I think I'm gonna draw, that's their spine. The spine is a great way. It's just, I always start with the head and the spine. So they have a little neck. Cats have very shallow chests. So dogs, I think what fucks a lot of people up between cats and dogs, so cats, their rib cage, it looks like this. It's shaped like this. With dogs, they're more, because they're ambush predators, they, their hind legs are more muscular. With dogs, which are more of running and stamina hunters and other canines for the most part. So this is their neck. Their cats usually have their necks sort of craned a bit lower too. Their heads are, when they walk, are usually more or less level with their shoulders. Dogs usually keep their heads up more. Their chests in the front are bigger and then they get smaller at the back. That's why dogs usually have skinnier waists than cats. So their ribs are more like this. Right. which I think a lot of people draw their cats with these really deep chests, and unless you're drawing something like a cheetah, that's not like, that's not really the shape they have. Cheetahs have super deep chests because they're runners, so they have really big heart and lungs. So they have a bigger heart and lungs, basically. So, and then cat's shoulders are kind of like a rhombus, I guess would be the shape, because it's their scapula. It's shaped like this. Forearm is really short, or upper arm's really short, forearm, paws, there you go. Pretty easy. A little bit of a chest muscles here. They don't have a collarbone. Their arms are actually not attached to the rest of their skeleton. They're attached completely by muscle, so a cat cannot dislocate its shoulder because it does not have a collarbone that has a shoulder joint. So there, that's fun. That's also why they're so bendy. So this is the spine. If I'm drawing just musculature, so their hips are kind of shaped like this. So if a cat's really sick, I'll draw that as well. So I'll just use this as a base cat, I guess. And then you're drawing the hind legs. Don't feel afraid to just simplify it. Also, you don't need a ton of detail. It's animation, after all. That's what I draw for. So, and then the tail is an extension of the spine, basically. And it's like this. So, a skinnier cat. Like, if you're going to draw a cat that's supposed to look unhealthy, an easy way to do that is this. When you line it, make the shoulders jut out. Maybe make the spine a little bonier. Make the hips pronounced. Skinnier legs. Just, like, basically, like, make it skinny and then have the joints kind of jut out because they don't have as much fat and muscle on their body. So they would kind of be shaped like this. It's the easy way to do that, like a starving cat. The head is displaced. And then back of the head, ears, nose, neck. Like, if you're drawing, like, a blood clan cat, so, you know, whatever. I don't know what there is to do with cat fur. It's just, you just do this, like, I don't know. Like, a warrior cat, I don't know, if you're gonna turn this into, like, a fucking, dove wing or something. It's pretty easy. So, you know, thicker fur. Cats sometimes have like a little mane of fur. Chest fur comes off here. Goes in. Shoulders. You don't really need to draw the shoulders all the time. You can just sort of have them at the bottom of the body. And it's, as long as you imply the right shape, it doesn't matter. She's kind of chubbier. Body. Legs. Fluffy tail. Like, that's a pretty basic cat shape. You can just, if you want to, like, when I draw a cat and I'm animating it, like, really roughly, no matter the pose, I do head, neck, spine, then I'll draw the rib cage. Then the hips here, legs come off, scapula, front paw, back paw, tail. So, like, you can really pose them any way you want. Oh, I don't draw realistic fur, sorry. Then you can take this pose. She's looking this way. So this can be the chin. The neck will connect here. This is their trachea. It's down. Back. It's the back of the head. Muzzle poke out. Try to, like, you know, what the direction is. Try to make things, like, wrap around with the head. Like, the eyelids and muzzle. Like, keep it. Because if you draw everything on the, like, if the head is looking up in this way and I drew everything on, like, a flat plane, you know, that doesn't really sell the motion as well as if I wrap it, right? You don't need to draw the whole chin all the time. Just a line, little line will do. As long as you imply the right shape, you're good. Eyes. Ear. And a little fur. Chest fur coming off. Draw the bump of the shoulder. This is the shape. So, like, cat legs are basically just cones. They're just shaped like this. You draw the paw off it. Like, and then then there's, like, a rhombus at the top. It goes like this. I mean, not always you can. That's to replicate how wetness makes things a darker color. So you can do that. But, you know, everything's conditional. Wrist, toes, forearm, wrist, toes, small chest, their spines. Dogs have kind of straighter spines. Cat spines are more arched. Dogs, this is their neck. Their spine kind of goes like this. Cat spines kind of go like that. So you'll have this back go. So this is more in front, right? So I'll draw it in front of this line. I won't draw it like this, because that's not the right shape. I can draw it like this. I don't know, man, then it's wet, and then you draw the fur pointing down. I don't think you need me to explain that. You can just look at a picture. So, like, hierarchy of line can help you with proportion. I mean, not proportion. Perspective. So, like, this leg coming out will be, because this part is more in front, the light line will come out here. The foot line is more in front, will come out there. I know it's pretty basic, but I see people mess it up a lot. Cats, not necessarily. I don't think they have longer wrists. No, it's kind of the same. Maybe there's a slight difference. I think maybe dogs have shorter paws a little bit, just because dogs mostly just use their paws for running and cats use them for grabbing things. I think they're a bit more prehensile than dogs are, so maybe they're a little bit longer. So, like, as people mess this up a lot, when they don't need to, it's like when they'll draw a foot from this angle and then they'll put, like, this line in front. And then draw it like that. And it's like, no, because it wouldn't look like that. It kind of messes up their perspective. And then, you know, bottom of the foot is like that. Connect it. Blah, blah, blah. So that's pretty easy. And then the tail comes off the spine. Yeah, so you can basically draw any pose you want with those kind of basic shapes. If you look at a cat's spine, it's like this, and the shoulders are like this on it, and then the rib cage is under that, and then the shoulders are on top, and the muscle for the shoulder kind of goes like this. But anyway, I don't know if I'm gonna be deleting it. I guess I'll leave it up if people really want it. Maybe I'll take it and I'll cut it or something, because I was just drawing at the beginning. I'll just put a timestamp. So this is the neck. This is where the neck would connect. You can draw the bottom of the jaw like here. There you go. So as you can see, I didn't use a reference for this, but I'm pretty familiar with cat anatomy. If you're drawing a cat, basic construction is head, spine, rib cage, and then build the legs off of that. And basically, just basic instruction for legs is this is the shoulder. Forearm goes a little bit like so. Shoulder. Upper arm goes a little bit behind the shoulder, and then it comes back to the front with the whatever it's called, front arm, forearm, forepaw, and then it comes down. So like it's within a rectangle basically, but if you draw a rectangle, it kind of zigzags in that rectangle, right? So, shoulder, back, forearm, paw, and then the paw probably line up about with the front of the shoulder, if it's just standing straight, and then you can do the same thing. Oh, I have to poop. If with the hind legs, where it comes to the front, goes to the back, goes to the front, right? And then you can flesh that out however you want. Hold on, I have to go to the bathroom. Ugh. I'll be back. I'm back. So, I guess that's... Oh, my shit is glitching so much. I guess that's it. I'm not really one to go into specific. If you want to learn to draw something in like specific detail, you could probably look up that on Google, and they'll explain it better than I ever could, I guess. And animation stuff also is probably all on Google, better than I could ever explain it. But that's how I draw cats. So. Do with that knowledge what you will. You should make it into a video. I don't want to. I'm lazy, you guys. I'm sorry. And I don't want... I hate my voice, and I'm not going to record it or anything. I think I made this cat too short. I think I need to make him longer. I think that's what's bothering me with this. And it knows itself. Isn't my life as much more? I'm not gonna show you how to do lip sync, because the way I do lip sync is fucked up. And you can just go watch an Aaron Blaze video on lip sync, and it'll be eternally more helpful than anything I could possibly provide. So, I guess that's it. The more that you draw figures and stuff, you'll kind of get it. Like, when a cat's paws, like, or just anything's hand is like this, versus when it's like, you know, slightly turned to the side or something, you'll see that the bones kind of overlap and twist over each other. And you'll find a way to sort of incorporate that into how you draw things. I've been doing it more. It really helps kind of sell motion and stuff and improves your anatomy. Oh, I don't think my lip sync is bad. My method is fucked up. And you should probably learn a lip sync method that isn't fucked up. I don't even know how to explain it. Also, that sounds really long and tedious to explain and make, and I don't want to. What is it called? If I can find it with the bone. Like, your radius and your ulna, if you take your arm and lay it palm up, and then just turn your wrist and look at the bones in your arm, you can see how they're sort of wrapping around each other. They're turning. I draw people all the time. They're turning around each other. They're sort of... Because don't move your, don't turn your whole arm. Like, don't move your elbow. Just move your wrist, like you're turning a doorknob. And you can kind of feel and see how the bones in your wrist are sort of, I mean, your arm are turning around each other. They're sort of wrapping around each other. It's interesting, and it helps a lot to know, because it changes the shape of the arm. And, like, you can do a lot with implying where the bone is and stuff if you know which way they're laying on top of each other. I don't make YouTube ad revenue. They demonetized my channel, which is super epic of them. Sorry, I just realized there's nothing on the screen. And then you'll sort of get the hang of it. A big thing only if you're going for it, you can go for more flat styles and animation, and it's completely fine. Is learning form and turning things in a 3D space. It's hard. It's a pain in the ass. you try animating things, like turning a box around and whatever, and you don't even need to post it, but it does sort of help you get a better handle on, like, you know, shit like that. Another thing that helps is constantly checking your proportions. Like, you look at your drawing and you go, oh, why does this look weird? Try flipping the canvas, and it'll help you sort of see where your proportions are wrong. Measure your parts of your body next to the other parts of the body. Like, if you draw the face from a three-quarter angle and you go, oh, this looks wrong. Well, it's like, well, is your one of your eyes smaller than the other or something? That usually can help even the face out, or is it too high? You know, shit like that. It's important to animation, too, because you're moving things around. And then try to kind of make anchor points in the body, like, be like, well, when I'm moving this head, I know that the midline of the eye will always line up with the bottom of the ear. And kind of knowing where things are in relation to each other when you're drawing a character moving around will help you keep that character looking consistent. Like, oh, I know that his nose bridge is, like, half an eye width, like, half the width of his eye just about, and that the bottom, mid of his eye lines up with the bottom of his ear, and that he has, like, four tufts of hair on his cheeks, and they start from the bottom of the ear and go to just below the mouth kind of thing. If you keep that in mind, it's easier to make your character look consistent between, like, extreme poses or different shots. It's staying on model, basically. But that's basically what staying on model is just sort of learning where all these... Because, like, I know some people sometimes are frustrated when they're doing big motions. They're like, oh, it looks weird when I move it. And it's because you have two drawings, but the proportions aren't the same. So when you animate in-betweens between them, it's gonna look a bit weird. That's my advice, I guess. I'm a third year at animation school, so I just got hired to do work on the Lackadaisy short as an animator. I noticed that besides a few of my friends, I'm one of the youngest people there, which is kind of nerve-wracking. I'm only 21, but that's my advice. And you know, watch, like, when you're watching an animated movie or even go and find clips on YouTube, try to watch it slowed down, kind of really pay attention to how they draw things. I know it's, you probably hear this a lot, but it really does, like, help to just sort of pay really close attention to work other people have done. It might give you ideas, like, you're watching it and you're like, oh, I've been having a lot of trouble doing that specific motion, but I see how they completed that motion here, and now it makes sense, and now I feel more confident in my ability to execute it. Stuff like that is pretty helpful. You know, I guess that's my advice for animating things. And then the more you do it and draw it, the more that you'll get better at it. That's really the biggest thing, is to just practice. And sometimes you gotta draw the same character, like, 7 different times to even sort of start to get a handle on what they look like. Like, I'm drawing Mordecai right now, right, from Lackadaisy. He may not look like it, but his proportions are very particular on his face, so if you get them wrong, it just really doesn't look like him, and something looks off. And I've been drawing him, probably drawn him, like, 8 times, and I'm still kind of struggling with getting him to look right, but I'm getting closer to being pretty on model with him now. Or decently on model with him, I should say. I'm sure that my director has things to say, but that's my current struggle, I guess. Or, like, I'm gonna, here, I'll open something Because the lackadaisical characters are these versions of them. Are designed for animation, so they're probably good for me to explain this concept. So, yeah, I have Freckle here. So, he has a round head, round eyes, his ears point up. If you don't draw, like, his eyelashes at the bottom, or, I guess they're not eyelashes, they're more like cat eyeliner. If you don't draw them at the bottom, then his face would look wrong, right? If you don't draw them the right way. He has four little things on each side. He's very cute. He has a round head. His proportions kind of emphasize roundness and circular, like his little cheek tufts, you know. They round out his face. He has a bow tie. His hair is rounded, and then Mordecai is, like, very pointy. His eyebrows are pretty extreme and pointy. His ears are back. He's very triangular. And then, with Mordecai, if you don't keep the tips of his eyebrows lined up with the end of his, eyeliner here, it really won't look like him. Right? And same with Freckle. There's a reason these characters look so distinct, and it's like if you just drew their markings on their face without keeping any of their shape language in mind, it wouldn't really sell them as well as it does, right? That's my shits. That's my dissection here. Here, let me close. It's probably gonna animate now a little bit. Let me close Clip Studio and open Adobe Animate. Hold up. I just so many numbers on it. Let me. Oh wait, this is the wrong file. Sorry. Hold on. Okay. Let me switch windows. All right. Sorry. Hold on. Okay. Oh fuck, that's such a mess. Alright, I don't need these layers anymore. Which layer is this? Okay, I don't need this anymore. Yeah, alright. Okay, so these aren't on the right layer because I just exported them into Adobe Premiere, and that's where I'm putting all of these on the right layer and whatever, so ignore that. Guys, I have an OC. It's my icon. It's in a Pokeball. Like, I think there's some proportion morphing with my Ash fur, because I animated this kind of a while ago, but I tried to keep his face pretty consistent, even though he goes to some pretty extreme expressions here. Right, and then Squirrel Flight's down there. She's a little bit different looking. And then as you can see with his paws, my method of drawing paws there is what I use with sort of the break, you know, where I break the joints in certain places and whatever. And his body shape and whatever is everything that I've said before. sort of where how I structure the face is the same. With cats, you know, when you're structuring the face, you can anthropomorphize their face a little bit, give them the eyebrows and whatever, and it's fine. As long as you know, like, the basic sort of skull stuff. It's not tweened, I just move it at different times. I mean, like, it's going to be, that's all done in Adobe Premiere, because that's where I put everything together. Because I can put some effects on it, whatever, and blur things. So the log, it's not done in Flash, it's just a still image, but in Adobe Premiere, parts of the log shake that he steps on and whatever. What do I like about my Rory part? So, when you're working on a show, I know a draw for maps with a lot of people is seeing all the different artist styles and whatever, but when you're drawing a show, that lack of consistency is bad. You don't want characters to look wildly different between shots because it's jarring for people. You want to stay on model as possible. Of course, small stylistic differences are fine. Most people won't notice them. You just have to make sure you're staying on model. The job of a director on an animated feature and assistant directors and shit like that is basically, you'll draw, like, a pose. And so you're gonna animate a shot for a storyboard. You'll draw a pose. Try to stay on model as possible, but if you get anything wrong, you would show it to your director or a revisionist, and they will go, oh, well, you drew Mordecai's arm like this, but if you want the pose to sell better, you should draw it at this angle, because it'll sell the motion better or whatever. And stuff like that's really helpful. Or they'll be like, oh, you drew his face like this, but his eyes are actually a little bit closer together and they're a little bit bigger and his nose is more so in this position. And just the job of a director and other people is to make sure that everything is staying consistent. Yeah. But I guess for tears, I don't know, tears are just kind of like water that rain to me. I just try to draw them with water physics in mind. These are kind of like Ghibli tears, though. I guess that's kind of how I draw them. It's kind of like huge. But, you know, I don't know if I really have a technique. I just kind of wing it. And then fire, looping fire is hard and sometimes looks bad. So I just draw like shapes moving and you should be fine. Just get the general shape of fire. I need to get better at drawing fire, but, you know. And I guess make sure that your tears are being affected by the motion around them or something. This animation's a little janked, but, yeah, it's whatever. I'm almost done with this part. I put embers and stuff here. I was thinking of doing smoke, and then I was like, yeah, fuck that, that's too much work. And then a helpful thing with animation to sell motion is, like, overshooting. So instead of having, like, the motion, going in a direct, like, let's say you're going from place to place, the character gets to that spot and then it just gets there and immediately stops. What can help sell the motion, I did it on his ears because he moves his head pretty sharply. So his ears are lagging behind his head a little bit. Then when his head hits the place, his ears overshoot a little bit, as in they go a little bit farther than where they're going to end up being. See, they like go back, and then that's basically where they stay. it makes it a little bit snappier, because that's how things work in real life. It sells it a bit. I think more people should take advantage of overshooting. It makes your animation, like, because it's you can sell more motion with less frames. Or like here, I did a slight smear with his foot going down. I made his paw get a little bit longer in between these two frames here. Like the claw gets longer, and then it hits the thing, and it squishes a little bit. You know, stuff like that can help. Just little things. I don't know. I guess that's my advice. I'm tired. I don't even know why I'm tired. I took a nap already. My favorite type of music. I don't know. I don't know why my iTunes mini player is still open. I don't have that show open. I like a lot of music, but when I'm drawing, stuff that isn't too involved, I guess, so it's not distracting. I guess that's all my advice for now. I don't know. I'm slow as hell, so I don't even know. A while, I guess. Yes, I need to work on this. Yeah, I have overlap shit here. The most she overshoots, so she comes in pretty hard. Overshoots, head goes here, ears overshoot later, they drag behind her, because her head is what's center of motion, she moves back here. It's a little bit of a smear frame. Okay, so like, stretch, her eyes get big, she blinks and it squashes, overshoot a little bit, smear, pose, yeah, and then in motion. Oh, it's loading. Okay. So she like twitches her nose. So it's like once you sort of get the hang of it, like this, I animated this pretty quickly. It's not that hard. It's just, I guess what's hard is learning everything and learning how to apply it sort of effectively to sell your character acting. I guess that's my current advice level. And then, because I don't have lip sync on this yet, but. Here, wait, let me. So now I have my audio off or down or whatever. Let me turn that up so I can play this. So, like, you know. Very basic kind of lip sync there. Like, she just says girl. But, you know, she. And her mouth twitches to the beat, I guess. And then, you know, kind of knowing where the shapes are on her face, also like her markings and where they are relative to other parts of her face, so that when you animate it, they're not like moving around, is something to keep in mind also. I only use Clip Studio Paint and Adobe Animate, but, like, you know, whatever. Oh, this timeline is clean because there's, like, nothing on it. This one is more messy just because there's more layers, but I like to keep things organized or else it drives me crazy. And you can see here, like, when I'm talking about muzzle stuff from earlier, is I connect her muzzle sort of directly to her cheekbone instead of drawing a line to her eye, and it kind of gives her a better face silhouette. And, like, here, you can tell she has a muzzle. I didn't draw many lines about it, though, because when she moves, the muzzle will, you know, go out in front of her. It's not like it's flat on her face. So of course, it being in motion also sells the shape of her face. So you don't need to be super detailed with muzzles a lot of the time. Because cat muzzles are pretty small compared to some other animals like dogs. Hi, owl. I don't know what else am I animating now. I need to work on that later. Oh, I have a lip sync that I did. Because I was going to make an AMV and then I got lazy. Here's a lip sync with a lot of motion that kind of describes what I, with like cat muzzles, how you can just sort of imply them. So I have a lot of animation tricks here. So like what sells his muzzle is like when I move his face, his nose, like when he moves to the side, his nose moves a little bit more than his eyes and stuff do. So it gets the feeling that it's further out in front of him. There's a stretch, a little bit of a squash, the hair and stuff is dragging behind, and then it falls when he's already hit the head position, head turn. Have the mouth, the jaw sort of catch up to the head when he's talking and turning his head. His little breath. I'm sorry for the scrubbing noise. This has a lot of squash and stretch because he's kind of violently talking, so there's a stretch and a little bit of a squash. And then there's an overshoot here when his head comes closer to the camera and then gets a little bit smaller. And then squash and stretch when he's talking with his eyes. When you're talking with the jaw, it really helps if you have the cheeks sort of pull and squish the eyes. It sort of sells it. I guess I should do more work on that. While he was talking, I was, cause he, what is he like, dies of something. I was gonna have blood sort of slowly leak from his head, start covering his face, kind of like Silent Hill. So. I guess that's something. Let me see. What else do I have? So I guess I have a fight animation. I'm going to go over this a little bit. I need to work on this fucking thing. So okay, we got anticipation. So she kind of, her body gets ready for the movement, her face stretches, hits, there's like a cushioning, pulls back, there's, and she starts stretching and she runs, here she goes, She's running. Anticipation for the motion. Big motion. Little bit of a stretch. Smear. Because her paw goes between these two motions pretty quick. It's like all the way up here and it's down here. Actually, I have his underbite here. Let me fix it. I know it's really small and no one will notice it, but I'm a weird little bitch. I'll fix it later. So there's a smear there. And Hawk Frost also is anticipating her the whole time. He's getting his body ready, tail's going up. Then he jumps. Smear. He's rolling, little smears on his feet, because his feet are moving pretty quickly. Ivy Pool anticipating, lifting her arm up, getting in position for it, smear on her paw, big smear for the slash. Hawk Frost dodging. She lifts up her other paw. Another smear, he dodges. She, kind of a stretch when she's lunging, more smears on her feet. Have the tail with the follow through sells the action. Kind of a line of action extender. He's spinning around here, but I don't really have much of that done. So, and then when he's going to push her against the tree, smear. It's going to be super smeared. Because he's pushing her on her shoulders. Shoulder hits the tree first. Then her head is going to follow, hitting against the tree. And it's going to snap up from the force. And then it's going to go back down and get into place. And he's going to sort of emerge. He's going to talk, raise his paw, bramble claw, blah. I guess that's all I have recently. Yeah, yep. That's it. I guess that's all I have to say for now. I don't wanna draw anymore, so I'm gonna go. But I'll leave this up. I'll put like a timestamp for when I start talking about shit, I guess. Good night for now.